application number 16-02, the Reading Village Comprehensive Plan on this. This is a continuation, if I can get my dates right from, let's see, this is June. I believe we met in May last time, early May. And at that time, there was a revision to the plans due to the applicant, developer, purchasing or signing an agreement to purchase the Brown property at the corner, we'll say that, on that. And so consequently, that required a revision to his drawings, and that's what we are waiting for. We were hoping that they would come in time for reviews by residents, reviews by the zoning board, reviews by peer consultants, but that did not happen. Plans came in just this week. I believe it was Tuesday. And that wasn't hard copies. That was just electronic copies that came in. So consequently, nobody has really had a chance to give these a thorough review at all. So what's going to happen tonight is we will have a presentation by the applicant developer in regards to the new revised plans and what they're going to be doing, what the changes that have been made, and from there on in. And there'll be questions, discussion by the board, probably not too lengthy in that board has not had a chance to review these plans at all. And as I said, there's been no peer reviews at all as yet. I will open it up for public comment. Try to keep your comments short, and keep in mind that I know the public hasn't had a big chance to review these. We haven't had a chance to review them, and so we'll go from there. You know, the next meeting would probably be more discussion, you might say, about these plans at the next meeting, which would take place in July. On that. During the public comment, if I can ask you, only speak when called upon, and please state your name and street address for the record, and face and address the ZBA when speaking. Be respectful, stay clear of any personal attacks on the developer, and any shouting, clapping, other demonstrations certainly will not be tolerated on this. Let's keep this very polite decorum here on that. And I hope everybody has signed in up at the desk there that is in attendance here tonight. We certainly appreciate it. So at this time, I will call upon Matt to give a presentation on what has transpired since the last meeting.
All right, good evening, Mr. Chair. Matt Sinker, who's at the Development in Reading. Members of the board and the town officials and members of the audience. So first, I will apologize. We just got the plans in this Tuesday when we started. When we were here in May and we got that under agreement, it wasn't like we had a plan in our pocket. And we literally went back to the drawing board and went through many iterations of how to redesign this, incorporating that piece, while also keeping in mind what comments we've heard throughout the process. So we took the approach that it's better to do it right, because we had one chance really to redo this big redesign, and if it took us a little longer and it meant, you know, that it came out like it was, is I apologize, but we wanted to get the plans to the point we were comfortable with them and not rush it, which was part of the reason why we felt giving the extension last time. We certainly would have liked to have them in 2 weeks sooner, but it took a lot of work to get to this point. So I'll just walk through some of the bigger changes and overall changes, and then I'll hand it over to Peter and he can go through the architectural. I think what we're just looking at really now is the program changes and some of the facade changes that we've made to give you a general sense of where we revised the project, and then we could get as we move forward in the process and coming meetings into more technical aspects on engineering and traffic and stuff like that. So with that said, as we know, the site is, here's downtown Reading, here's the site right here, the Doucette moving. here was the certainly wood, and here's the Brown's Auto Body, so which is all part of the site now. So as now with this corner piece, this is how the site lays out. Some pictures, obviously, the existing building's four stories. It's about 45 feet tall. Looking at it from the other way, the Sterling Wood building is three stories, but it literally is at the zero lot lines to the neighbor there. It is right on the lot line. So I'll just generally, I'm going to just go over the changes we made program-wise to the project, and then we'll get into some of the architectural. So the biggest thing is we gained that corner piece, which is somewhere 6,500 square feet, so which made our site a little under 43,000 square feet. The other thing at the last meeting I said is getting this piece didn't mean we were going to increase the unit count. We actually decreased it. So right now we're at 72 units. So what that does is it makes your units per acre down from 93 units to about 73 units. So it's a significant drop. Those units, the 73 now, are majority of them are one-bedroom units. It's not set in stone, but we're comfortable, and we think that being a transit project, having one-bedroom units there, is, from a business standpoint, is a good thing. From the town standpoint, it has different impacts. Obviously, school isn't a 40B impact, but it is also something we're cognizant of, and I think one-bedrooms tends to alleviate some of that. From a square footage standpoint, we were at a 3.29 FAR before. We're now at a 2.28 FAR, which is basically your gross square feet of the building divided by the lot size. We've improved the lot coverage. We have a longer building, but it is improved lot coverage because we have more space. Maybe most importantly right now too is we went from a five-story building to a four-story building. And in doing so, we also made design changes that changed it to a flat roof. We keep the appearance of having a pitched roof with some mansard appearances, as you'll see in the elevations. But by doing so, we decreased the height from 63 feet 7 inches, which was the top of the peak, down to 45 feet 2 inches, which is in line with what is there now. So we, in essence, dropped the height of the building almost 20 feet. The parking count is one of the items that's been talked about a lot. With all one bedrooms, we're confident that the one parking ratio is good. It's an item that still is, you know, we're internally discussing how to add some more visitor spots. So we know we will hear comments on that, and it's not a set in stone item on our end right now. We're still working through them, but we that's where we got to now. So some of these dimensional changes are in line with what was approved, or less than what was approved at 30 Haven for the residential portion. So we're trying to keep that in mind with what the town has seen nearby. All right. So this was our old building. Didn't have the corner piece. Came back further here. Came close to the lot lines here. And that was just the layout of it. And this is, so in the red in this slide is the old building, and underneath it in the blue-ish color is the proposed new one. So I'll just point out a couple things. We're pulled further away on this side setback. We're pulled a lot further away on this rear setback. We're pulled an even further amount away on this rear setback to the neighbors. We're pulled significantly more away from this side setback here, and we've replaced the space here with what is now the corner. So we've added the density portion more to what would be more of like the commercial street on Lincoln across from the train station. We've pulled the building back. This before was a zero lot line. We pulled everything back so there's more of a front setback. And it's more than we proposed and more than that what's there now. So the setbacks, before we had a front of 0 feet proposed, now we're at 4 feet 11 inches. The side was 3'7", now it's 16'7", and the rear was 6'10", and the closest is 13'3". And those are the closest ones. They actually go further away from that in spots too. And I'll just, what I'll do is I will hand it over to Peter Bartash to kind of walk you through the architecture, and then we'll answer any initial questions. And again, sooner. We're very proud of how they come out, and we look forward to hearing from everybody.
So again, for the record, my name is Peter Bartosz from the Q3 Studio, and I'm actually going to take a step back really quickly to talk about some of the issues that were identified in this plan by both peer reviewer, but also board and members of the public. First and foremost, the lack of reasonable open space or even buffering along the sidewalk and along the streetscape. That was a big concern that we heard, and we really paid a lot of attention to that when we were trying to create a layout of the site. As a matter of fact, we identified that we've looked at easing the edge along Prescott Street and Lincoln Street even further. But I think the other thing that we've also looked to do is to clarify how the site is actually accessed and how circulation works on the site too. So when we look at the new ground floor plan, we'll start to see some of those relationships have improved. In the previous plan, we did have that elevated courtyard that ended up bringing the entire building edge of the first level all the way up to within 5 feet of that rear property line. And then you still had the parking sticking out underneath that podium edge too. So we were coming right up against the property line on that back edge, facing the abutters. Something we took to heart, and we said, you gotta be better than this. The trash room, the core locations, the entry to the building, all of these items were challenged by the town's engineers, by the peer reviewers, as being either functional or successful in their current configuration in this plan. And so we also took a look and revisited that. There were questions about whether or not we had adequate vertical transportation with one elevator. How were we gonna manage the trash, and how were we gonna deal with some of the other logistical challenges of the project? All of those things all of those considerations we've taken into account looking at the new layout. So again, you can see we also had this connecting bridge that separated this into what we call Building A and Building B, but for the purposes of looking at this as a project, we were considering this all to function as one building where people were traveling back to this kind of central core to get at services, to utilize a common connection vertically, but also the common trash room. And in the peer reviewer's notes, the architectural peer reviewer, he pointed out that when we showed the conceptual elevation of this project, we were describing what things looked like in Prescott Street, but we weren't going far enough to explain exactly how we thought this was going to look on the site and from the surrounding community. So what you're going to see is that we've actually taken some of the time between then and now to really investigate that further and look more closely at how this sits within its overall context. So here's the comparison we talked about a second ago, and here's the new first floor plan. So it does at first glance look like not much has changed, but a lot has actually changed. Right here, in this edge where I'm tracing with a laser pointer, that's the actual extent of the building above. So again, we still do have parking at the first level, and we also have 3 floors of residential up above that. But by nature of consolidating our actual building footprint up against the public rights of way along Prescott and Lincoln, we've actually managed to leave this outdoor space open on the rear side. So there's now no building in this, no physical structure in this zone other than the parking drive aisles and a few parking spots. That's opened up the opportunity to be able to landscape this edge. You have to forgive us, this isn't an architect playing landscape architect here. Here will be far more green screen on this edge. I know that there is a landscape architect on the team who's working on developing those plans right now. But for the purposes of illustrating the concept, we've started to go ahead and include where we could be seeing trees and shrubs and buffering along these edges. It's also improved the ability for personnel to be able to access the rear of the property now that they're not trying to squeeze through a 5-foot access corridor to get to an even tighter space behind the project. So we really started to improve our relationship to the rear along this back side. I spoke a little bit about function when I was talking about how the first plan was a little deficient. First and foremost, we now have a primary residential entry at the very corner of the project. When we start to look at the architectural design and the overall image of the building, what we're gonna see is that we're celebrating this corner. We're saying this is commercial, this is public. This is the moment that we want to be the focus. But then we want the building to start to quiet down and fall away as it moves further down the streets toward the residential edges on each side. So at this very corner, we've located our primary entry where we have our leasing folks and our kind of day-to-day activity. But we now also have a common amenities space for the project residents that's located at grade, that provides glazing along the street edge and really activates that corner, provides an active corner here that corresponds with what's happening across the street at the train depot. You'll see that we are now incorporating two elevators. And we've also improved the layout and configuration of the trash room within the footprint itself. So these are all uninteresting from a design standpoint. They're not things you're necessarily going to see, but they're actually really meaningful for the function of the project itself. And they're things that we took great care with considering and laying out as we went through. Looking at the upper floor plan, again, I noted that there's nothing being built above grade in this zone behind the project. And we still do have that central corridor that's loaded on either side of the units. At the very corner here, we've managed to free up some space for all of our building function. So we're talking about mechanical rooms, electrical rooms, tele-data rooms, all of the services that we really didn't have a true home for in the previous layout, we've really clarified and located here. You'll see at these very specific locations, we've also introduced some setbacks that are allowing us to have some balconies and to break down the length of the elevation. You'll see that when we get to the images. I just wanted to point out how that fits in the plan here. So as you move up to the third floor, you can see it's the same as the second. And then once we get up to the fourth floor, this is that floor that Matt was describing as kind of being nestled into the roof. You can actually see right along the edges suddenly, we start to see the roof creeping back and cutting into the units a little bit because we've really taken that roof and tucked the fourth floor down into it and used dormers along the edges to be able to get our head height and our windows that we need for those units. So we'll see what that means for scale. And I think ultimately there are two types of changes we're talking about. Changes that affect scale and changes that affect function. So we just talked about all the changes that affect the function of the building, and I really want to talk about what we're doing now to break down scale. The roof is still a flat roof. It still has its equipment out the top. So this is the previous north elevation that sat right along Prescott Street. We had this strongly articulated base, but again, this was a zero lot line configuration, so we had issues with where these projections fell in relation to the property line. We were concerned about our relationship with this roof overhang and the edges of the property as well, how that was going to be managed, how it was going to be maintained, what it meant in the winter. I mean, for the most part, I didn't hear anything too negative about how people felt in terms of the aesthetic and the design, but there are a lot of things that are being done in this design that are emphasizing how vertical this building was and the way that it appeared. So now, this is an overlay of the new building and the old proposed building on top. So you can see this is that almost 20-foot height reduction that Matt was describing earlier. And in a moment, I'm going to flip forward and we're going to see what lays behind it. But now you can see that we're starting to immediately bring down the height of the building just by nature of the fact that we're getting away from that upper floor. We've redistributed the units into that corner and we've lowered the overall roof and changed the overall look and feel of the project. So this is now the current Prescott Street elevation. At grade, we have just a simple rhythm of windows, right, that is open. They open into the parking garage, so it's not as if there's active space behind them, but it does at least give you the sense that this is more of a residential character and feel along that street edge. You'll see at the corner, we start to introduce more glazing as we get to the leasing functions and some of the more public spaces. And we've actually used a masonry material, so some sort of brick at this very corner to make this feel commercial, to make it feel like it has the most weight and it's anchoring the building at that corner. But as we move along Prescott Street, we've started to look at the relative block sizes of homes and their scale as you move along the street and thought critically about echoing the dimensions of the lengths of those houses as you move down Prescott Street. So now you start to have a smaller grouping with this mass and this mass here that break down the length. And then all of a sudden we introduce these balconies here that help to reinforce those breaks and give us some character and texture as you move down along Prescott Street. This line that I'm tracing here above the third floor windows is that's the what's called the cornice line or the soffit line. So that's at the underside of where the roof overhangs that upper floor. And you'll see here we have these dormers that are popped into this mansard style roof. And so from the street edge, as I'm walking down along a street edge that can now incorporate some buffering and planting,
I look up and I see this etch as it sticks out a couple feet off of the face of the building, and that's really what seems in my eyes to be the top from when I'm standing near the building. But the building does extend up past that by another floor, so when I step further away, I can see that other floor, but I understand visually that really this is the portion of the building that I'm experiencing as I'm walking by this and traveling against it. You can see that we do have the garage entry over here on the right-hand side. And as we turn the corner when we look down Lincoln Street, you're going to notice there are some similarities between how this side of the project is designed and how the other side is designed. We wanted continuity. We wanted it to be consistent. One of the things, as architects, we strive to not do is play Disneyland and pretend that we've got this built-up-over-time thing where someone came in 1920 and built a brick building on the corner, and then in 1950 someone did this. And so we want to be honest and say, okay, these are being built at the same time, so we're going to use a similar family of materials and details and similar tones and colors, but we're going to make some subtle changes with colors, with trim, joining windows. I know it seems like very small, subtle details, and also just some major changes in materials at the right corner to help break down the scale, make this feel cohesive, but give it individual pieces that feel more comfortable from a human scale. So we heard the comments about not being able to see the project as a whole. One of the issues with showing you pure elevation is that it does appear that this, if you were to look at this all in the same tone, it would appear that from this end is the length of the project. But there's never a circumstance where you would see the project in this form in real life, which is why we've got some perspectives we're going to show you in a second. But we did want to demonstrate that this elevation is the portion of the building that does start to go away from you at an angle if you were to be looking at the Prescott Street elevation straight on. And so if we turn the corner and look at Lincoln Street, I mentioned that there were some similarities between the design and the overall character of the elevation. And you can see that we've carried the same sort of language and motif onto Lincoln Street, and we've used another moment of this brick material at a vertical circulation where we have the stair going up, because we do feel that this street has a little bit more of a commercial character than Lincoln Street does. So as we get a little bit closer to talk about some more of the details briefly, you can see we do have all of the glazing at that common space for the residents at the ground floor. It feels active, it feels vibrant, it's a storefront. We have a pronounced entry canopy and some larger windows over that canopy to help signal your eye that this really is the primary entry for the building. But again, just by nature of the way that these pieces are stitched together, they feel kind of like a natural combination between this more traditional residential style architecture and this timeless commercial style architecture that are put together to make this building. So as we get up on Lincoln Street and we're facing back toward the intersection with Prescott Street, you can start to see that we've kept, instead of having major massive brackets now that we've scaled back the size of the overhang, we have kept that detail through the use of this dental kind of trim that sits at the very corners line of the roof. We're keeping projected sills on the windows, we're doing these panels, and we're also making sure that we're keeping a little bit more of a contemporary look by letting the fiberglass siding wrap the corner here rather than using the corner board. Very small, subtle details that help this feel more residential, help it feel modern, but make sure that it's not disconnected from the general character of the surrounding community that is residential and it is New England. And again, just looking at how this starts to establish scale, you have a very clearly defined base that has a certain size of opening and proportion of glazing to wall. And as we get up into the residential portion of the project, that proportion shifts to feel more residential. These feel like residences. It doesn't feel like an office building. It doesn't feel like something that it isn't. So we're trying to really be sensitive to that. As we look back at the corner where it does sit against Prescott, at the intersection of Prescott and Lincoln, you can see now by having this kind of active storefront down here, it does give you that sort of retail feel, even though there is no retail component on the project itself. And it makes this feel like it is addressing the public realm and speaking back to Haven Street across the tracks. But as you start to move down Prescott Street, suddenly it does start to make that transition and help you transition back to that residential feel. This is the previous side elevation that faced the residential neighborhood further down Prescott Street. Same comparison. We're looking at an overlay of that elevation in comparison to the new end elevation. And I'm going to peel away that overlay in a second. But the other thing that we're also showing here is the rear of the building that's further beyond. So this is the portion of the building that is on the opposite side of Lincoln Street and is in the distance from this view. Again, we're trying to give you an understanding of the totality of the project, but also want to be clear that when I'm at this point on Prescott Street, this elevation is the one that's right up against me, and you'll see that in a second. So we've taken the language that sits on that public street, and we've turned it around the corner. But we also recognize that the back of this building is very public because of its scale and its relationship to the abutters. So we've taken the treatment for these more residential pieces of the building, and we've carried that all the way around, 360 degrees around the building. So we're treating all sides of it and making sure that we're taking into consideration the fact that you will be able to see this building other than from on Prescott Street and Lincoln Street. So we heard some concerns about people wanting to know, what's this going to look like for my backyard? Now, obviously, it's a little difficult for us to get onto your property and take a picture of exactly what you have. So we've looked at some aerial imagery. We've considered what type of screening we could have along the rear edge of the property and said, what could this look like? So in the previous scheme, before we changed the design, the building edge would have come right up to about where the laser pointer is here across the street. It would have gone up a floor, and then you would have had a courtyard and open space that people could occupy that would have been right up against this very edge. We've pushed the building back, we've incorporated screening, and we've introduced this more residential style of architecture and character to help this feel a little bit more comfortable along this back edge. So to look at this in section for a second, the previous building section, you can see our full, more than 60 feet in height up to this portion here where we do have four stories over the podium. We've actually increased the ground floor to 12 feet of height, which will help with the common spaces at that level, help with the parking, coordination, access to that level. It was one of the concerns that we heard from multiple departments. But because we've reduced the building by a floor, we've been able to increase that height, but reduce the overall height of the building. So in the new section, you can see the dramatic difference in height as we drop not only from 4 to 3 residential floors over that podium, but with an entirely different approach to the roof structure as well. Taking a look at shadows, because the building height is similar to what's there now, and it's actually an improvement, the footprint is an improvement over the current existing buildings because it's stepped back from the property edge. You'll note that there actually isn't too much of a difference in terms of the shadows that are cast today. And so what this shows, and it's a little difficult to see with the light, anything in red is a brand new shadow that is not there today. Anything in black is a shadow that exists right now. And all of the times that I'm going to show you just quickly right now are really what we consider to be extremes. 9 o'clock in the morning when the sun is relatively low in the sky in March. 4 o'clock in the evening in December when the sun is extremely low in the sky. And you get really long shadows. So at 9 a.m. on March 21st, we are infilling this corner here. Right now there's a one-story building that's set to the rear of that property, so you are getting a new shadow over the corner of Prescott Street where it intersects with Lincoln. But as you move throughout the day, you'll notice that a majority of these shadows do fall on the street and in that public right away. And again, it's a little difficult to represent because there's technically no shadow on this building because it is a building right now, but when that building is removed, there will be a portion of our site which will be in shadow, but that shadow doesn't go beyond the edge of the existing shadow that's cast by that current building. This is at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, also in March. So by the time you get to 5 o'clock in the evening, the sun's very low in the sky, and you can see the new shadow falls across the open space to the backside of our site, and also falls across the tracks and in these public rights of way. So looking at June, when the sun is relatively high in the sky, you'll see that there is minimal spillage onto the side yard of our project and also onto the street here. Again, the same thing, minimal spillage onto the street here. And then we also have the shadow on the open space behind the building and out against Lincoln Street. In the evening, 6 o'clock, sun about to set, you will get shadows that do extend beyond the extent of the existing shadow that fall across the rear yards of the abutting properties here. So we wanted to make sure that was extremely clear at the extreme that would be an impact. September 21st, these shadows are going to be similar to the shadows we saw in March. So I'm just going to kind of go through them, and you can see how the changes occur as we track across the sky. And then we get into December, where the shadows are really at their longest. And you'll see that we're filling this portion here with shadow. We're introducing new shadow up here. We're introducing new shadow really across the street and onto the depot itself at 12 p.m. in the afternoon on December 21st. Here we're infilling this shadow, which is new, across the tracks. And then at 4 p.m., which is just before it's going to be dark, the only new shadow that we're adding is these three kind of slender columns that cast shadow here in the corner of our site. So that's an overview of the changes that we've made to the project, and we'd be happy to answer any questions that anyone has.
That's it, Matt, now for your team right now.
Just a couple other quick points. Just to be touched on, we have a landscape architect. There's one, a very preliminary plan that's part of the package. It's going to, I imagine that will also change. It'll include some maybe fencing or some other things that come out in the process. But we didn't have him come tonight because it was more important to just present the new plan with the new program. But he will be at the next meeting as well. So.
Okay.
Yep.
Very good, thank you.
So
right now I will query the board here in regards to if they have any questions or comments. David, we'll start with you first.
Thank you for the presentation. Thanks for clarifying some matters. Candidly, I haven't had a whole lot of time to spend in detail with the new submission. And so I'm going to defer most of my commentary till we've had an opportunity to have some more peer reviews and to give me a little bit more time to get into it. So I imagine that may even answer some questions. I see some strides were made in the right direction and perhaps a move in the right direction. And so I'm going to defer my commentary till we've had some more opportunity to take a look at what you've submitted. Thanks.
Okay. John, any comments, questions?
Well, I had some questions.
Okay.
One of the questions was the total square footage of the residential area in comparison to what was presented in the original project. Has that changed?
The total square footage has changed, a decrease in every area, yes.
Well, if we take off the top floor and we look at what the footprint allows us, have we changed the actual square footage in each of the units?
So I think the best way to answer that would be to say we've swapped multiple two-bedroom units for one-bedroom units, and that's decreased the overall size of the building pretty substantially. But we've also eliminated a lot of inefficiency. The previous plan had multiple unit types. There were 10 different one-bedroom units because of the funky building shape. And by eliminating some of that inefficiency and really tightening up the layouts of each unit, we were able to reduce the overall square footage of the footprint of the building as a whole.
Okay, do we know the number of 1, 2, and 3 bedroom units then?
We do. It's 61 bed units, 3 2-bed units, and 9 3-bed units.
61
beds, yep.
Yep.
3 2-beds.
3 2-beds and 9 3-beds.
And those are required to provide.
Okay. Another question I had was you had made, I think, a great proposal on the total height of the building. You increased the garage area from 9+ feet to 12 feet. Have you changed the height within the corridors of the residential or the actual units? Or are they still 7'3" or?
So the garage was measured from the garage slot to the top of the second floor. That was 10 feet 8 inches, so that's now 12. And all of the residential floors have a floor-to-floor measurement of 10 feet 8 inches, which results in a 9-foot clear ceiling height within the units and within the corridors, which is consistent with the height we had.
Okay. One thing that I see that you have not done yet, and I think we're probably still waiting for it, is a list of the waivers that you will be seeking with this new proposal. We just got this as everybody else has, so just as David said, trying to digest all of this takes a little bit of time. And then after that, with the peer review that is basically going to come in, we need to know what the options are relative to the waivers requested and so forth. I could see that, and I compliment you on what you have done in terms of the setbacks. Are the setbacks sufficient? Don't know yet because we haven't figured all that stuff out. Haven't heard from the peer review people.
Yeah, we've already drafted one that as we get some comments, but we'll provide a revised waiver request as we need to do as part of the process. Clearly the purpose, you know, the tenants is getting the plans out in the public, and obviously everyone needs to kind of look at them. So we do have that updated. Setbacks still, we still need waivers on them, although some of them are very close, they still need waivers. We tried to just outline the changes, and then we'll submit that new waiver request separately.
Yeah, the only comments that I had, Mr. Chairman, is that I think that this proposal with the increased size of the lot makes a major difference. Shrinkage from the five-story or the total of 63.7 feet down to 45.2 is a definite direction that I think was the concern of many of the townspeople as well as I think of some of the board members. But in terms of comments, I don't have any comments now because I haven't seen, as David mentioned, we haven't got far enough into this and we're just seeing it for the first time about a half hour, 45 minutes ago. So.
Exactly. Well, microphone if anybody needs it. Sai, would you have any questions or comments?
I don't have any questions because as everyone has said already, and I think the rest of the board will acknowledge, we haven't had a chance to digest this change. I would acknowledge, though, that it is a noticeable step in the right direction. And I think it does move in the direction of trying to ease some of the concerns that people in the town and the board have had. I think there's a ways to go. And I think it's imperative that we have the time to digest this. We have the time to get inputs from the peer reviews. And we need to try to get, hopefully, before we have a next meeting, that effort to have taken place, that the peer reviews, re-reviews have taken place, and there's been discussions between the applicant and the peers, so that we can sit here at the next meeting and start moving in the direction of making a decision. We've been here since February, and I certainly would acknowledge to you folks that I know you've been trying to work out the deal with the garage guy, and it takes some time, and it's happened, and that's great. So we've basically started over at this point in time. So I applaud the presentation. I think it's a step in the right direction. Does it go far enough? I think we haven't had an opportunity to digest that yet, nor have you. I think we need to do that. But I am very anxious to move in the direction of closure on this thing. We did extend it 90 days. 90 days is going to come and go awfully fast. So I think we need to get at it. And I'm looking forward to the next meeting, whenever it takes place, that we start getting into the real basics of finalizing the situation. That's all I have.
Okay. Thank you, Sai. Kathleen.
And I would agree with Sai. I'm just, at this point, I really have no comments. I think some positive, you know, some improvements have been made, but at this time, I really have no further comments.
I'm not going to reiterate what everyone else just reiterated. No comments for now.
I was just off the cuff. I have some positive comments. I would say I do like the reduced height. I think it's more in line with the neighborhood character, like we did with the dormers. The setbacks appear to be better. and I like that now there's an opportunity for landscaping. Another impact that I liked was the mix that you did with the housing tenure in regards to the units and having more one-bedroom units. I think that would help with parking and the parking ratio. My only question would be, when you said you had to have 9 three-bedrooms and 3 two-bedrooms, what do you mean by that?
It's a 40B requirement. You have to have 10% three bedrooms. So actually, if you have 8, you can have 8 three bedrooms. It rounds up. So any 71 units or more, up to 80 would be 8 three bedroom units if they have a requirement. There's no requirement relative to any other unit type, studio 1 or 2, but there is a 10% three bedroom requirement for any 40B project.
Thanks.
Like the other members, I will refrain from making any detailed comments in regards to the plans until I do a more complete review myself. And I know the peers are on that too. In fact, I was just handed an email from Traffic, Green International, traffic peer reviews on that. And obviously, they just got the plans themselves, just had a chance to take a quick look at it. And I'll just read a couple of blurbs from it, really. It's a small little email. Let's see. Thank you for sending the revised plans. I'll hold off till I hear from you regarding the schedule to go forward. And I think what that brings up then, and correct me if I'm wrong, Gene, Julie, are we still expecting money from the developer in regards to peer review? We have not got that yet.
Correct.
Nope. Okay. So consequently, we will not be doing any peer reviews until the town gets a check.
We don't have an estimate from the traffic engineer.
Okay.
They pay a check for the civil engineer to review the water right. And sewer report, and to provide a check for the architect. So
sure.
We can only, you know, we don't.
Well,
I haven't seen anything from the traffic engineer.
Right, and that's something that will be worked out with daytime government here in the peers.
Yeah.
What I'm concerned about, and I think what probably the board is very concerned about, and I know Cy alluded to it, that. You know, we have a 90-day extension, but this is going to go awful fast here. Now, if we're still waiting around for checks and for you to get an estimate from the traffic, whether that is adequate or not, where we don't have the money yet, peer reviews could be delayed 2, 3, 4 weeks. And here we are as a board looking at, oh, we'll probably have a meeting come the third week in July, and we'll be having a more detailed review of this. Well, if the peer review hasn't completed by then, we're certainly not going to have a detailed review of the project. So we need to get this ironed out.
We have no desire to take any longer than we do, so we want to proceed. I think for us, getting the plan done was a huge effort, and we made a lot of changes. And it wasn't just something, we didn't have this laying around that. So we, spend a lot of time on it and a lot of money, and we're looking forward to
being
peer reviewed. We're confident that it'll be positive.
Right, and I agree with the other board members. I think we're heading in the right direction here, based on comments that you heard from the board on the previous plan, from residents on the previous plan. I like this one. My personally, just seeing it tonight, what we have here. But I know there's still questions in regards to this. And I'll continue here just reading. I mean, the traffic consultant noted that the applicant hasn't provided dimensions for driveways, circulation aisles, parking spaces. And our original review, we also requested vehicle turning paths within the site, particularly to demonstrate how trash pickup would be accomplished. I believe that the applicant also indicated at the ZBA meeting back in March that they would provide parking demand data from apartment communities with similar proximity to a commuter rail station, off-site parking utilization studies, and potentially expand the study area for the traffic impact and access study. So it sounds, And I'm sure the other peer consultants will have the same reviews on these plans. They're certainly not detailed enough for a detailed peer review.
It costs a lot of money for peer detailed plans, and I think the program, getting a program that's headed in the right direction, is the first step we had to do. If we compare every detail and then have a peer review, then have to change it. We're, you know, we're moving with the process, and we'll, you know, we look forward to getting in, as I said, to those technical details as we move forward. And our traffic engineer and our civil engineer, who aren't here tonight, are working on it. And I'm sure, you know, as we get more feedback on the program, so if something program changes that changes these traffic configurations, then we'd be having to rechange that. So we, you know, we're trying to start with the program first and the big concerns we heard about height and density, and then work into the more technical aspects of it as we get more direction from the board. So we're, you know, looking forward to that process.
Right, understandably. But you can also see, you know, where the town's position is here. We need to get the peers on board here to start reviewing these. The peers need details. Obviously, they're going to need detail enough to review it. They're not looking for final plans, certainly, and I don't think we're looking for final plans, but we do need enough detail to be able to do a peer review on these. And I think you should be consulting with the town on that, and letting them, you know, and they will let you know what the peer needs. And I don't know if there'll even be a go-between between you and the peer consultants, or between your engineers and their town's engineers. But this is something that you need to work out with daytime government on that. Yeah. So
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, John.
Would it be appropriate at this point to ask Julie or Jean, in terms of the time frame, because we have to, at the end of this meeting, we have to move to a point forward that's definite. We can't wait because it's got to be advertised. We have to know what's going on too. Would it be appropriate at this point to ask what the calendar looks like and what
sure.
we may need by the different time frames on that?
Sure. One point of clarification, the only outstanding money that we need is actually for the architecture peer review. The other two peer reviewers can go ahead starting tomorrow. The schedule, as I understand it, is full on July 7th, but it's open on July 21st.
Right.
So I would schedule this next hearing no sooner than that, and that's a month from today. I don't know if that's enough time for our peer reviewers, but in the past, the turnaround has been fairly quick, so it might be.
Okay.
We need to check. Yeah, we will need to check.
Okay. And now we do have an extension, Julie. Do you know offhand now what the critical dates are coming up in line? Isn't it? We have to have a decision. Is it December now that we have to have a decision by?
I believe the extension was for until November 1st.
November. Okay.
Correct.
For the public hearing.
Yes, yeah,
yeah.
The public hearing.
For the public. Okay. Very good.
Are we going
Thank
to be
you.
Able to meet that now with the another month of July, just for the peer review, and then come back to the board to discuss that, see how the neighbors now will feel also with respect to those changes, and where we're headed then? Is that sufficient time for us to review, make recommendations, and still meet our deadline for November 1st? I have no idea. I'm just throwing that out to you.
Yeah. That's a tough question to answer at this point, since really no town staff have reviewed the plans. You haven't reviewed the plans.
Right.
So it really depends on what major outstanding issues there might be. I would say you could probably continue for another month and then at that point decide if you want to ask for another extension. But I think I should defer to town council on this one.
I think I agree with all of that. I think it's impossible to say. I assume it'll be tight at the end of the hearing. It tends to always be that way. But as we're sitting here now, not having had a lot of time to look at the plans and not having had any time for the peer reviewers to look at the plans, it's hard to say what we're going to be hearing from the peer reviewers in a month. So I think with the understanding that these plans were, when we were last together, these plans were promised 2 weeks ago, I think, and came in 2 days ago, I think it would be okay to, and we have until the end of November, October to run the public hearing. I think it would be okay to wait and see what the peer reviewers say in a month, and then if we need to ask for another extension at that point, we could level that request to the applicant at that time.
Yes, Jean.
Yeah. My only concern is that we continue to bring up the issue about the outstanding payment. We've been talking about this basically since the last meeting. Very shortly after the last meeting, we requested the funds, and we have not received them.
You'll have it tomorrow.
That'd be my only to work closed tomorrow. So that's my only concern, is that it's been several weeks, and we've provided tremendous detail on where the estimate, how it breaks down, what the hourly rates are. I just don't want to continue to be in that mode of trying to defend the peer review amount. As Julie stated, it's simply for the architectural review. All of the other reviewers just need the material, not payment. So it puts us in a very precarious position to be trying to manage this process forward without sufficient funding to direct the architectural peer reviewer. And so I was hoping that we would get the check tonight, and now I'm hearing that we're not. So I have concerns.
Thank you.
Can I make a comment on peer review?
Yes.
Relative to traffic peer review, I understand the need to get details on interior driveways and parking spaces and whatnot, and I will get on my clients to do that. The peer review for traffic should be very simple and not an elongated period of time. This is a reduced density. The access points are the same. The volume does not need to be redone. So the scope, people are making it sound like this should be a 3 or 4 week activity for traffic peer review. It should be a couple days for the peer reviewer to do that. I've done and been involved with enough. Relative to the architecture peer review, we paid $11,000 to an architect. Now, I understand it needs to be re-reviewed, but in my experience, that is a lot of money for one peer review to look after. We understand the need, and you'll get the check, but I just want to go on the record to say that we're not particularly happy with the amount that the architect has been charging for this kind of peer review. So I'll just say that we're going to pay it. We understand that it's important, and it's important for the board to make a decision. Relative to the traffic peer review, there's no way on God's green earth that shouldn't be done in its totality in a month from now. So we will work in good faith and get the peer reviewer the information they need, and we'll continue with the process. But I just felt the need to say that.
And just real quick to touch base on the civil peer review, we were told the town actually engineer found the report that the town had prepared. And we gave additional funds for the town peer reviewer to peer review the town's report. So we, you know, have no problem in those technical items, and everyone's been reasonable. But we have our town engineer has been working with the town engineer and identifying things in the report. So we are, you know, making progress on the report.
I'm sure the peer reviewers will act accordingly in haste, and you know, and try to get this project done as quickly as they can. I don't expect it's going to be a 2 day turnaround like you noted. Here we are waiting on your plans that are 2 weeks late. We're first seeing them now, and then you expect our peer reviewers to turn them around in 2 days?
That's not what I said. I said it's about 2 days effort. So by the time they get all the work, I'm saying by July 21st. I didn't say we expect them to turn around in 2 days. I said by July 21st.
2 days effort.
16 hours of time, I think they can complete this peer review.
Okay. Sai, do you have a question? Comment?
No, I have a comment.
Okay.
You know, what we've seen here in terms of a presentation, as I said earlier, is a step in the right direction. Frankly, I think whatever peer re-reviews you have ought to be pretty simple and pretty easy to do. And frankly, I don't understand why we couldn't be sitting here a month from now and seeing the results of those reviews and having comment from them, and we could start discussing it, okay? I don't think the peer review should be very complicated. I kind of agree with this gentleman over here. It shouldn't take much effort. We could almost sit here and look at the previous peer reviews and what they've done and almost draw our own conclusions as to what the peer review is going to tell us. So I hope we're not making a big deal out of a little deal. I think we need to build a fire with this candle and get this process moving. And I don't want to be sitting here 2 months from now still wondering what the peers are going to tell us. We should be able to know that and discuss it and move on within a month.
I think
certainly without any doubt, by the 21st of July, we ought to be really getting into the meat of the problem here, the meat of the issue. That's my view.
No, I think we will, Si. I think in my experience and what we've seen from the, the first submitted plans, the peer reviews turned it around pretty quick. And I would expect they would do the same thing here. But I don't expect that they're going to do it with in 2 or 3 days either.
Well,
it's going to take them.
We need
you
to
know,
start,
give
we
them
need
some,
to start taking
some,
the
some
timelines
reasonable time.
Serious. We need to start taking the timelines
yeah.
more serious than we seem to be doing. That's all I'm suggesting.
Okay. Any further comments from board? If not, I will open this up for public comment. As I say, if you would keep your comments short and to the point, realizing that these are new plans and that they're not really detailed as yet. So if you'd raise your hand, give your name and address, I will take comments. Yes.
Leanne Starr, 96 Washington. I looked at the plan today, but I noticed a slide that we had. I highly mentioned the building about the trees and fencing and planting. But I saw that there's a slide that I didn't see in the plans. Those are due tonight, those slides?
Yes.
Will those be available online?
Yes.
And you did mention something about fencing. I'd be very concerned, and I would like to see fencing, not just trees, because I have 2 kids, and it sounds like there'll be more open space in the back, which is great, but I would just be concerned about seeing for the back of the building. And I also didn't see the back of the building. I didn't see those in the plans on Tuesday. So I'd like to see what I've been looking at from my back there.
Oh, okay.
Nick Gagnon, 76 Washington Street. I'm in the butter to the development. So just to expand on the previous comment, one thing that I saw in the new plan, I think I saw in that new slide showing the project from the back, is balconies from the back that we would be looking down our backyard. That's definitely a huge step back from my perspective relative to the other plan in that regard. Having people stand on their balcony 40 feet high looking straight into our backyard is not ideal. And in fact, when the developer came to my house to discuss the first design, I actually brought this point up around my concern around having potentially having balconies there, and they had assured me that there would not be any balconies in the project, so I said that has been forgotten that redesign. The fencing too, I know we haven't seen the landscaping, but the fencing, we have our cars being parked right next to our backyard, so having fencing that not only hides the view of the cars, but also would block the noise of a running car would be, I think, important from the privacy of the abutters. And another comment that was raised previously around fire safety. I'm not sure how the new design addressed the issue of a fire truck being able to gain access to the back of the property if need be. And then the last comment I have, which is more of a high level general comment, is I hope, and I think I've heard some of that from the board, but I hope that the board is going to review this revised plan by anchoring themselves not to what the previous design was, because the previous design was completely unreasonable, but rather what the project should be to blend in the community and in this neighborhood, which is, by the way, a single family neighborhood. So yes, this is a step in the right direction. This is less dense, but this is still a massive project. So I hope that the town is going to think about this not in terms of the previous design, but what this should be.
Nick Aiello, 92-94 Washington Street. I just wanted to, one thing I had on my mind when I was looking at these, some of these was the balcony, so I would be interested in hearing more about how this has changed with the number of balconies and the location as they look into the backyards of the abutters. Thank you.
Okay. Yes, if the architect, if you're prepared to respond to their comments, certainly I think we're interested in that.
If you went to the last point, so in the back where it's pulled in, one spot is stairs and the other spot's balcony, so there's three. On the whole back, there's one stack of three balconies, so there's one, two, three. We had that outdoor space there before. We pulled everything back there. It's not an end all deal, but it was just, it's on the overall. But it was just that one little corridor where they're stacked in one, two, three. So that's where they.
That is one stack of balconies in the back?
That's it.
Right there, yeah.
And that was where the connection kind of between the building pods, it was a natural break. So nothing where we could continue that discussion.
Okay, thank you. Yes?
On the same subject, I'm just.
If you could name an address,
sure.
Please.
John Yerowich, Fairview Avenue. So there are three balconies that's been established in that one quarter. Does that mean it's not as good a view from the windows down to the same backyards? I don't want to sound like a wise guy, but it seems like the purpose is it's a privacy issue. And balconies or windows, it's the same view. It's the same position on privacy. Am I wrong or, excuse me? I don't mean to sound disrespectful, but it just seems like the issue is whether balconies or windows, it's still imposing upon backyard privacy.
Mm-hmm.
So what could be done about that? Could there be higher trees put in or something of the sort to alleviate some of that?
Okay. Thank you.
Of course.
Yeah, we'll certainly take the comment under consideration. Yes?
Christine Moore, 75 Green Street. I'm just concerned that we're still showing 72 units, 72 parking spaces. The 72 units add up to 93 bedrooms on my calculation here. You've got the train station right there. People are still going to have to drive. I live two blocks down. I walk to the train station and take it every day. I still need my car for groceries. I still need my car to get to the line. I still need my car in bad weather. And that bad weather I could not get across Main Street because the sidewalks were buried under the snow. So just a reiteration that the parking, the number of cars that will inevitably be in this building is going to be a real impact on the area.
Yes, you. Yeah, right here, ma'am.
Lois Bell, 35 Washington Street. I echo that about the parking. Even though they are single units, if there's a couple living there, each working, and one works in one town and one works in another, that's two cars. So I'm wondering where all the excess cars are going to be put. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Jean Thomas is 21 Arlington Street. I appreciate as a neighbor who's going to be looking at this right on Prospect, I appreciate the new appearance that it fits more like the design of my neighbor's house and the scale anyway. Are these changes affecting your price ranges? The size of your apartment, the changes you had to make Do those affect the price of your rentals? In that area where you have the leasing on the first floor in the club area, but mostly the leasing, and then that glass continues up the other floors, what's in those spaces?
It's all resident.
So they have different kinds of windows. They have some very big windows. Okay, that's residential. All right, thank you. I'm glad to see that there are two entry and exit. Put in a second entry exit. Again, going on to the parking. With these changes, there's still, you had a very small provision for parking for visitors in the past. Now there's none. So I won't repeat what these other people have said about parking. But who will take the responsibility of this overflow? Is the town willing to accept making a deal about parking in the public lot at the train station? Or somebody's, this is going to really fall hard somewhere, these extra cars. And who will be the final responsible party? Thank you.
Okay.
If I could just jump in.
Yes, Jean.
The way the parking works now at the train station is there's no overnight parking. So during the day, that's available if you're a resident, but you can't park overnight. It's full.
Mm-hmm. Yes, back there, Jean. Yes.
Hi, Jenny Blunt at 99 Prescott Street. The last slide that you had up there showing the back of the building, my concern when I saw it the first time was that it paints a very pleasant picture of a nice green backyard where indeed there is driveway.
The one with the balcony. Yeah.
Isn't there a driveway through the backyard?
So the view that we're looking at here actually is taken from the neighboring property. So this is not our project here. This is all existing backyard space that belongs to other people. This is roughly where the property line sits. Then here on this side is this new green space. So on the other side of that, you do have a driveway that does connect back through. And like I stated in the beginning, it's a conceptual rendering. It's not intended to mislead or misrepresent what we believe to be there. It's based on what we can see in our professional opinion, looking at aerial imagery and trying to diagnose what this view might look like.
And important to note, that's not a land, that has, doesn't have a landscape architect on it. That's for you to see what the building looks like from behind. So things like trees and size of trees and fencing and all that stuff isn't shown there, which would be added at some point.
Elevation to the back. Yeah, I think you want to see it. Okay. So,
Jean, down here we have a question. Comment?
Yeah.
Jocelyn Wright, Prescott. Having no experience with this kind of a project at all, how from demolition to time that the last Chevy Silverado drives off the lot, how much time are we talking?
From that first day of demolition to the last shift.
And how many units have been designated as affordable housing to go towards our subsidized housing units?
They all count because it's in the rental.
25% of them are actually affordable units, but all of them count in terms of the state's count for their inventory.
Yeah.
Rental. Jonathan Barnes, 41 Pratt Street. I just want to echo the concern that the board has about the lack of the waiver requests tonight. I understand everything was put together pretty quickly this evening, but I want to echo that concern. The zoning bylaw, the waiver requests are critical, at least from my perspective. The zoning bylaw requirements, I think I expressed this in an earlier meeting, the zoning bylaw requirements are the town's interpretation of how it perceives an appropriate use of its land in terms of the requirements relative to the height, the lot shape, setbacks, and a whole host of things for which you are asking for waivers. And it's impossible to assess what this is going to look like without understanding that. I had expressed previously that the bulk, the shape, the size, the massing of the building was, in my view, entirely inappropriate in terms of the way the town perceives its needs in its zoning bylaw, because you were asking for some significant waivers from a lot of those requirements. And I don't know what you're asking for now, but I still would have those same concerns and ask the board to consider those concerns as theirs as well. You had previously asked for significant waivers from the lot size. You had asked for significant waivers from the building height, significant waivers from the maximum lot coverage, side setback, front setback, rear setback, lot shape. And as this gentleman had pointed out, which I think is important, we should no longer be concerned with your last proposal, but we should be concerned, and I'm very concerned with respect to your current proposal or your future proposal, when I can assess the waiver request to see whether they continue to be inappropriate in terms of deviating from the zoning bylaw requirements. So I just want to echo that concern about not having those waiver standards or those waiver expectations. I also want to raise one other issue. You have demonstrated the shadow effect. I just want to point out, it was probably pointed out previously, there are at least two historic structures in this area, Parker Tavern, but equally important, the Rent Depot, which is a significant historic asset in this town. And I noticed that your shadows are creeping across the street over that historic structure. And I, for one, expressing, I'm on the Historic Commission, I just want to express on the town's behalf some concern about diminishing that historic asset or the perception of that historic asset. Thank you.
Gene, over there.
Eileen Manning, Riverside Drive. First, I'd like to mention that the pictures you had shown when you had the first proposed building and the second proposed building, for me, it would be more useful to see that against what the current building looks like to really understand the scale of the current proposal. So I think that would be helpful for us, where this one we have up, where you're seeing how large that one was. Well, what does Doucette and certainly Wood look like, as opposed to this building? I'd also like to express for much of the community our frustration that we're now at a second meeting where we don't have a whole lot of information to be able to really respond. And that it gets more, it feels a little like, it's harder to get people to show up because they're not sure they're gonna have enough to respond to. And that, it was Wednesday before there was anything for us to look at to know, what we were going to see. And we weren't seeing all the information we needed to really know, did this address all the concerns?
Yes. Yes, this lady here.
I guess with the parking and hearing that there are 93 bedrooms, that brings up the density question again. That accelerates the anxiety to hear that there are that many bedrooms and that many people who will be in this very small neighborhood. The three properties that are involved in this are messy, complex properties. They're old, they have varied uses, and surely there are toxic materials within them, below them, on them. So You may not be able to answer this now, but I think we need a very clear plan of what the mitigation of the environmental effects of the demolition itself will be, please.
Thank you. Okay, there's one more in back, Jane.
I'm under the impression that under the new set building is asbestos shingles.
Okay, no further comments right now. I will close the public comment portion for tonight. Question I have is, I'm listening to public comments and et cetera, and looking at the plans that we do have here. When we got the first plans, they were certainly a lot more detailed than what we have now. Architectural plans, et cetera, elevation wise. Do we expect additional
we did the exact same package with more information, more elevation shown with this on the architectural. There's more civil plans to prepare.
Well,
again, I know it's hard, you know, doing this until we get some direction and have the feedback on the program. Some of the other items aren't, not that they're not important, but the timing isn't as important now. So to know certain things that may change because the architectural changes that would impact something we've already then, you know, vetted out and discussed and peer reviewed, that may have to change and get re-peer reviewed. So I think program-wise, and I want to also point out, we took the architectural peer review, went through every recommendation that was made in that, and had it, and tried to answer everyone that was previously made. So the frustration that it's now a double amount of peer review to review this, even though we have that peer review, which is a lengthy peer review that we went through and addressed. So we'll continue, but there's certainly more work to be done on the civil end of it that was from before that we were working on. But I think there was the direction on the program. You know, we took off the floor, we increased the setbacks, the dwelling units per acre was reduced. Certain things that are inside in terms of the flow that we addressed from the architectural peer review. So we, you know, what we're hoping for is some guidance at the next meeting, more, you know, on all the peer reviews, but specifically that one, so we can then craft where the building, the direction of the building is heading. So the technical stuff that takes time to do, but actually the actual work on it isn't, you know, as long as some of the other stuff. Work out in upcoming meetings.
Right.
So it's not all going to get worked out at the next meeting.
Well, I see. No, and the reason I ask is, you know, you gave us a perspective tonight of the building. As you see it, it says perspective facing northeast along Lincoln Street there at the corner of Lincoln and Prescott. And you've heard questions tonight from about the back of the building. I think an elevation at the back of the building would certainly be helpful for the board and for people. I don't know if we need it for the exact ends, but typically when this board reviews architectural plans, we do get elevations of all four sides of a building, and we don't have them here. I think they would be helpful. I don't believe it would be difficult to get them.
The package we actually, the presentation that's here is now, we submitted it to the town. We were working on this today on different, and there's other elevations that we could add to it if somebody, I mean, now that it's modeled, it's a lot easier to look at it from, you know, from Mr. Allo's backyard or from someone else's or from the corner, so we could then kind of see where, more specific for people, but for the board too. So,
sure, well, that's what I'm getting at, that We would be expecting more drawings, more details to come in for us to review. I would, you know, this just isn't it. If it is, it's a very minimal package, and we would have a lot of comments on this one. That's what I'm saying. Elevations would be helpful, things such as that. Dimensions on parking stalls. I know these are questions that are going to be asked. Yeah. Okay. Any other comments, board members? If not, John, yes.
I feel the frustration as a member of the board. I feel the frustration of you and the public not understanding all of what's going on. I understand as a person who is the developer who's trying to develop this piece of property for 40B is very different, not for them, but for us. Because a 40B says that you're going to give waivers that are not in the zoning bylaws so that this can be done. And it's done only because we don't meet the state standards for affordable housing. So as we go through this, the bigger the project, the more involved it is. To vet the project properly takes time. I'm frustrated by the restrictions that the state puts on us that it has to be done in 180 days. The bigger the project cannot be done in 180 days. If we want all of this stuff, there's going to have to be some give and take. And I think that because the town of Reading does not meet the standards, that we have to look at this and see what the best project that we can produce for everybody, not only the neighborhood, but for the town of Reading, to meet our minimum standards for affordable housing. In my experience in sitting two other large 40Bs, Johnson Woods, and then also that turned into a PUD.
Reading Commons.
And then Reading Commons.
Yeah.
And then the earliest one, which is similar to this, is Archstone, which is down on the other side of West Street. Those projects took better than a year to fully vet them to get what we wanted to get out of it. Are we happy with them? Some people are, some people are not. But I can see from the developers, time is money. Every time that you do this, you're upping the cost of the project, and there's more and more to put into the details that this board, and you as the public, but this board has got to make that decision on. So the frustration is there. We just need to take it a little bit slower. I know that Cy wants to move forward. I'd like to move forward faster, but at the same time, I want to make sure that everybody knows what's going on, and that is there has to be something coming out of this 40B because the state mandates it. So what can we do to get us through this process? And the process is the developers give us their input, we kick back on them, tell them what we expect from it, and then we try to negotiate something in the middle. And that's between daytime government, nighttime government, which is us, the developers, and you being in the neighborhood. So keep this in the back of your mind as we go through this process. It's not going to be done overnight. That's the only comment that I have.
Okay, John, thank you.
Can I just add one?
No. Public is closed right now, public comment. You can comment next time. I will open it again for the public comment, but right now I just closed it. Okay. Any further comments from board members?
One more.
Cy, yes.
I think John summarized the issue quite well. There are state requirements that we have to satisfy, which are at odds, conflict with our town zoning bylaws. We have to take all that into consideration. And I don't want to put a lot of onus on the developer here, the applicant, to say, you need to give us this, you need to give us more of this, more of that. I think any one of us who sits on this board could sit down and look at the waiver list, for example, that was presented with the original proposal, and look at the changes here that we've seen so far, and probably could come up with a pretty good reassessment of the waivers required without any further input from these guys. I think they ought to give it to us, but in the absence of that, I personally, I think, could move forward and figure that out by myself. And there's probably a lot of other parts of this new proposal that we could do the same by looking at what we were given previously and drawing a very logical conclusion as to what it should be today. So I think the onus is on all of us, the applicant, us here on the board, and with inputs from you folks, that could accelerate this process. and I'm going to push for acceleration. I know it takes time, but I like to move quickly. And that's what I'm going to try to do as a member of this board.
Okay. Further comments from board members? If not, Gene, Julie, any final comments before I adjourn?
I would comment that this presentation that was shown tonight was not submitted prior to tonight, so it is not on the website currently, but it will be on Monday. I will post it on Monday.
Yes, Gene?
Yes.
I'm sorry. Sure.
So I think what we're saying is when we come back on July 21st, we want to try and have, again, enough of information in advance of the meeting to share with the public, to have on the website, and sort of, and I know the team has worked very hard on a lot of major elements and appreciate that, but just out of respect for the public process, we would like to be able to facilitate the information that's available. So assuming that we can move forward with the peer reviews, and kind of agree that we're not in the same situation next time we meet, that the information has been queued up at least a week in advance. And so that would be, I think, if there's general agreement about that we can all work together to make that happen so that there's enough time for the board to review everything, enough time for it to have been on the website and the public can review everything. And again, at least having that 1 week in my mind, would be what I would recommend, and I'll defer to the chair to clarify that.
No, I think you're right there, Gene. Yeah, we need a week at least.
Should we ask the applicant, is the 21st of June sufficient
time? Well,
that's
what we need to decide now, is what we will continue this meeting until. Right now, we're looking at July 21st as our next open date. I don't know if that's sufficient for you.
Architecturally, we have everything, and traffic-wise, we'll go back and look, and we'll check with our traffic engineer. I think some of those items are civil items that the traffic engineer is talking about that have to be addressed. I think the civil component is probably the component that needs the most work at this moment, based on where we were with the peer review, but now that we're kind of getting in the direction, we've got plenty of time for the architect and the traffic, and I imagine we'll be able to.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
It sounded like, and correct me if I'm wrong, the architectural aspect of it needs to be ironed out here before the architect peer review gets done.
What you have tonight is is everything we have that we would submit to the department.
That you will submit to the architect, but then we need some cash. We need,
all right.
Yeah.
You need some time. I imagine 4 or 5 weeks is enough time. 4 weeks is enough time for.
Okay. We need you to be working with daytime government then to get the architectural peer review up and running on that. And I think you know what that means. Yeah.
I want to make sure the scope was the appropriate.
So as I said, we're looking at July 21st as our next open meeting. Is that sufficient time for you?
Yes.
So you're willing to you'll be here the 21st and going over peer reviews hopefully, and we will have, as a board, looked at things and have comments. So that's what we will be planning for on the 21st, and I'm sure the community will have comments that night also after their review of your new plans. Okay. I would entertain a motion from a board member then for a continuation of this application until July 21st, 2016.
So moved.
I have a move. Second from John Jurema. Any further comment? All those in favor, raise your hand. A motion. Okay. Next meeting will be July 21st at this location again. Okay, 7 p.m. I know they had on the agenda here minutes of May 12th. I don't know why that's on there.
Yeah, let's defer that.
No, we're going to defer that, I think. I know the next meeting we have July 7th. There's five sets of minutes on that to be reviewed and to be approved.
We have postponed it.
Yeah, we keep postponing it.
Yeah, so I would have assumed May 12th was in that view. I haven't had a chance to look at it. So, be prepared. We'll have five sets of minutes anyway on July 7th.
Was there three cases?
I would, pardon?
Was there three cases on top?
There is. Two of those cases are continuations.
Motion to adjourn?
Yes, I'll accept the motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn?
Second. Second from John Jurema. All those in favor of adjournment? Okay, thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Adjourn.
Sounds good to me.